Star Wars, The High Republic, Beware the Nameless. Written by Zoraida Córdova. Performed by Todd Haberkorn. Chapter 1. Bilboosa City, Nalhutta. Churro the Hutt was having a very bad day. First, someone had been in his greenhouse laboratory eating his science experiments. He was almost certain it was the grumpy Gamorrean palace guard, because only the tank filled with a growing cool sap shrub and red snoroop mushrooms had been disturbed. Churro had wanted to see if the species native to Gamor could not only grow in Nalhutta's expanding swamps, but thrive. Now, he had to start from scratch. Second, no matter how many times he told the cook that he was a vegetarian, the messy Toydarian served him fried wort and Krukra Rocha beetle salad with his green juice. His father hadn't let him leave the gathering until he'd finished every morsel of his breakfast, and his cousins had sneered at and mocked him all morning. Lorco, the meanest of his cousins, had shoveled an extra helping onto Churro's plate.
Eat up, baby Hutlet, or you'll never be as big as me.
Everyone laughed and laughed. Churro wanted to say that Hutlet already meant baby Hut, so Lorco was being redundant. Also, Lorco was older by a few planetary revolutions, so of course he was bigger. But at just about a meter and a half, Churro was short compared to the relatives who were his age, too. His sister always told him he was a later bloomer, but that wouldn't stop Lorco from playing his favorite game, called Toss the Chuba on the Churro. He managed to land one of the slimy purple frogs on Churro's head as the younger Hutt sulked back to his chambers.
Look at him go, off to practice your basic.
Lorco taunted him until Churro was out of sight. Most of his cousins didn't speak anything other than Huttese, but Churro liked learning new languages. He could make out gruff Gamorrean and was working on some Rhodes, but he had problems with Rhodian vowels. He had dreams of going to a university where he could learn how to care for plants and insects and discover new species, and languages would help with that. But his parents expected him to fold into the family business, enforcing hut protections on smaller worlds, filling the palace coffers, crushing their enemies, that type of stuff. As he slid through the corridors, several of the guards gossiped behind clawed hands. In fact, he'd never seen so many guards at his family's palace before. Some had been brought to Nalhutta after a recent skirmish on the planet Ina. One of the Nikto guards told Churro he'd lost his finger when the Jedi attacked their stronghold and took their food supplies to give to the local Inami. Churro thought the food had belonged to the Inami in the first place, but the last time he'd voiced sympathy like that, his father had been furious. Nalhutta felt like the moments before a thunderstorm. Churro could feel it in the way his parents spent more and more time with others from the Hutt Council, whispering, scheming, planning, and the way his first and second and third cousins warned that something huge was coming. A chance for the Hutts to strike back against the horrible Nile marauders and nosy Jedi. Churro had a very bad feeling about all of it, even though he tried his best to be an optimist. When the doors to his chambers slid open, he let go of an anxious breath. He was ready to roll himself onto his giant bed platform, but quickly realized he wasn't alone. Someone was in his greenhouse laboratory. He was going to catch his plant-eating thief red-handed.
Hello?
Churro called, annoyed, even though he wasn't very good at getting angry.
The sign on the door clearly says do not enter. Flesh-eating flora and fauna inside.
When he went through the archway that led into his greenhouse lab, he didn't find a thief at all. Standing among the rows of exotic plants and terrariums filled with bugs from all over the galaxy was Dahara, his big sister. She was 5 years older and three times his size. She wore a hat with a long silver braid, The hare had belonged to a Gagorin bounty hunter who had betrayed the family and spied for the Nile.
Oh, it's just you.
Churo placed a palm over his racing heart.
Hey.
Dahara's orange eyes were narrowed at the ant colony as she watched them carrying dirt from one side of the tank to the other. She reached for the lid.
I wouldn't touch that,
he warned.
Unless you want your skin to blister and pus like tiny volcanoes for days after they bite.
Dahara retracted her fingers. He could never quite tell what his sister was thinking. Sometimes he wondered if she even liked him, or if he was just another thing in the palace that annoyed her.
Is that so?
She never took an interest in his bugs and plant collection. Churo was thrilled.
Oh, mighty stars, yes! These ants come from the volcanic planet Mustafar. I found a few in a cargo shipment of minerals, and now look! Their skin is thick to withstand the volcanic terrain, but I'm hoping I didn't ask all that, Churo. Right, of course.
He shook his head, forgetting a chuba was still clinging to the microbinox atop his scalp. It slapped around in an attempt to flee, like it knew what was coming. But Dahara was too fast. She swiped it in her meaty palm and gobbled it up. While her lips smacked together, he glanced around the greenhouse nervously. His mother had convinced his father to build it for him so he'd be out of the way. Dahara never visited him there. Never.
So...
He looked from the prickly thorn hanging from the ceiling to the neon woolly caterpillars getting ready to spin their cocoons, to the empty tank of Naboo bamboo.
What's up? It's time. Time for what? It's time for you to join the family ranks. You can't hide in this treehouse forever.
Churo wanted to point out that it was a greenhouse, not a treehouse, as they were not even in a tree, but he was too preoccupied with everything else she had said.
I am in the family ranks. I'm a hut of the triumphant Diversific clan.
He knew proving yourself to your family and performing coming-of-age rituals weren't exclusive to huts. On Dalna, children underwent the metamorphosis trials. His history tutor had told him of the ancient peoples of Arano, who dropped their kids in the desert with nothing but a dagger and expected them to survive and return as warriors. He was probably lucky he didn't have to do the blood hunt of the beings of Cathar. Still, shouldn't it be enough to be his parents' son? Why did he have to start going on dangerous missions to prove he belonged in his family?
Good. Because we have a job. Let's go.
Dahara turned to the exit that would spit them out onto the palace grounds.
But...
Churo felt short of breath.
But my ants! They just hatched, and I need to measure their progress. I can't leave them. Then bring them with you,
she snapped.
You cannot hide among your critters and useless plants at a time like this. The family needs you. I need you.
Churo didn't think he was hiding, and he had never really thought anyone needed him. Not the way his plants needed him to water them, and his bugs needed him to feed them. He also knew Dahara would never, ever admit something so emotional, unless it was important. Perhaps deadly. So the youngest hut in the palace nodded and said,
I'll get my things.
Dahara didn't say where they were going or how long they'd be away. Churo hadn't been off-world in many rotations since before the Nile Marauders claimed their territory and created their occlusion zone in the Outer Rim. So he packed as many nutrition patties and green juices as would fit in his backpack. He transferred a couple of dozen ants into a small sealed terrarium. The last things he grabbed were his field vest with a dozen pockets to collect field samples and his data pad.
Churo!
His sister shouted. He let out a high-pitched wail and followed her across the palace grounds. Ever since the flesh-eating plants, known as the Drengir, had ravaged Nal Hutta, the ground and air felt different, thicker and swampier. He wanted to study the effects, understand how a creature's infestation could transform parts of his homeworld. Maybe he'd prove that his plants and bugs weren't as useless as his sister thought. But for now, he had to be preoccupied with Dahara's secretive hut business, whatever it was. They didn't stop moving until they reached the palace hangar. Droids soldered and fixed the guts of ships, sending sparks into the air. A group of four-armed basilisks stacked durasteel crates in the bellies of giant haulers.
What's in there?
Churro asked his sister, then regretted it. He knew better than to ask.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.